How is everyone? Are we good? Yes. I'm going to say it one more time. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Come on in. That's right. Come on in. All right, you need to tell all of them out there we're getting started. Jesus is in the house, and they're out there, so too bad. They miss out. Go tell them that. Tell them I said that. Yeah, there you go. It's not going to matter.
In trouble.
Huh? Jesus is in the house. They're missing out. That's all. Listen, before we get started this morning, I just really felt like as we come into, you know, this place that we call the sanctuary, where we all congregate and meet and give God our worship, I just kind of wanted to do something. I just wanted to kind of pray that those who are coming in, that your hearts are ready, and if they're not ready, get ready. You should have been ready. Oh, did I go there? And just, you know, because the Lord is good, and he is worthy to be praised. The Lord is good, he's worthy to be praised, and he's worthy to be praised in his sanctuary. And this is kind of what we call that little section. So if you haven't gotten your heart together, we're going to take a second to get that together. I know the kids are ready, right? You guys are ready to worship, aren't you? Yeah. Just don't get near the candles, all right? Just don't do that. So, Father God, I just thank you for all my brothers and my sisters. Father, I thank you for all you're doing in each and every life that's represented here. Father God, I thank you that there are no mistakes, Lord, when it comes to you and what you do in our lives. Father, I thank you that everyone here that loves you is called according to your purposes in Christ Jesus. And so, Father God, today as we lift up worship to you and praise to you, Father, let it be a sacrifice, and let it be a sacrifice of praise. Let it be a sacrifice of praise that, Father God, like you would in the times of old, that God, you would come down and you would actually consume the sacrifice. And so, Father, I pray that you would consume everyone in here with the praises that belong to you, Father God, because you're worthy. You alone are worthy. Father, I thank you that we are all set apart and sanctified for your purposes in this house. And Father God, I pray for the worship team, that God, that you would use them mightily as they break through the barriers, that Father God, that would keep anyone from entering in to what you would have for them today in worship. And Father, I pray for Ron, I pray for the word, I pray that every heart here today is prepared to receive what you have for us today. And everyone in the house said, in Jesus' name,
amen.
Amen. Joy.
morning and it's Sunday. You know what I'm saying? It's Sunday morning. But guys, it's Sunday morning. Yeah. Right? Like, how many times a week do you get to do this? On Sunday mornings. So every single second counts. Do you hear what I'm saying that I'm not saying? Right? Okay. Just want to make sure we're on the same page here. So I'm not saying, like, you know, okay, make this happen. Whoa, okay, gotta wind, you know, this is not what this is about. This is about celebrating Jesus. Because he rose on Sunday morning, right? He gave us eternal life on Sunday morning. He broke the chains of bondage on Sunday morning. He took care of all sickness on Sunday morning, right? He set us free on Sunday morning when he rose, meaning that his sacrifice was enough. It was enough for us. And he will be worthy forever. Jesus, you are worthy forever of a sacrifice of praise and of thanksgiving. You're worthy, God. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, who rose again and gave us access to God's presence every minute of every day for the rest of eternity. That doesn't even fit. That doesn't even fit here. So Jesus, I just pray for fresh revelation. God, I pray that you would just come in whatever way, shape, or form. We just want to give you freedom, God, to be who you are without dictating to you what it needs to look like. And we want to worship you in spirit and in truth. Spirit and in truth. So just pray, God, for a fresh impartation of your spirit, of freedom and of joy, of love and of peace. Patience and goodness, long suffering, kindness, mercy. Because where Jesus is, where the Spirit is, the fruits of his Spirit are also there. So just close your eyes. We're just gonna look at you, Jesus. We're just gonna look at you.
Tears of sadness. madness. My heart can't keep it. I'm shouting, shouting. Oh, 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 oh,
Jesus. I am chosen, I am free, I am living for eternity. Free now and forever, you pick me up, turn me around, set my feet on solid ground. Yours now forever. And nothing's gonna hold me back, no, nothing's gonna hold me back. Nothing's gonna hold me back, no. My chains fell off, my heart was free. I'm alive to live for you. I'm alive to live for you. Amazing love, how can it be? You gave everything for me. You gave everything for me. You wash my shame and sin away. The clay is clean, a brand new day. Free now forever. Now boldly I approach your throne to claim this Christ through Christ my own. Yours now forever. Let's try that again. You wash my shame and sin away. The slate is clean, a brand new day. Free now forever. Now boldly I approach your throne to claim this crown through Christ my own. Yours now forever. And nothing's gonna hold me back. No, nothing's gonna hold me back. Nothing's gonna hold me back.
Free to give, free to be, I'm free to love you, free to love. gave everything for me. You gave everything for me.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Wait on you. Just wait on you, Jesus. Yeah. The chains fell off. My heart was free.
I feel like I got a word, and I don't know who it's for, but it was when Jesus told the disciples to step out of the water, and I feel like somebody's wanting to step out of the water, but they're scared right now, and just to fix your eyes on the Lord, and just rejoice, and just be happy in what he's doing. And if he's telling you to step out, I just want to encourage you, just step out in faith today. Don't hold back, just step out. Jump, leap, do what you have to do.
To seek, to thirst.
first love come away. Do as you did at first. Spirit and wake me from my sleep. Blow through the caverns of my soul, pour in me to overflow. To overflow. Awaken my soul, come away. To hunger, to seek, to thirst. Spirit to overflow, to overflow, to overflow, to overflow.
But the fact that we have salvation, that we have an intimate relationship with Jesus Christ, that is one of the most beautiful things ever. And we need to rejoice. We need to rejoice that we have Jesus and to cling to that.
The Lord gave me a word for this morning, and I was going back and forth about sharing it because I didn't want to talk too much. But it keeps coming back to mind. I just felt like the Lord said that part of this morning would be warring for dreams. God has good plans and good purposes for us. He says so in Jeremiah. And the enemy knows that. And it's to his benefit if the dreams of God could get frustrated. And there's a lot of different reasons why that might happen. Sin is one. Resistance is another. Faith or lack thereof is another. Bondage, addiction, depression. And we could make a huge, long list. And I felt like the Lord said that during worship this morning, there would be a grace and a favor to war for dreams. To war for individual dreams, whatever it is that God maybe has spoken to you as an individual, that you feel like it's just a dream and it will only ever just be a dream. And God says, if I've said it, it's not just supposed to be a dream. It's supposed to happen. So that might be something that's individual for each of us, and then collectively as Marietta Vineyard Church as well, to stand up and say the dreams of God for this church, for this body, are not supposed to just be dreams. They're supposed to come to fruition. They're supposed to be real. And he gives us authority, both in the natural and in the supernatural, to take hold of his dreams. And so I just want to encourage you as we continue to worship, don't neglect the subtlety of God's voice to say, hey, do you remember when I said that? Yeah, that was me. And that's a dream that I have for you. And I just want to encourage us together, collectively this morning, to allow the chains to break off so that each one of us can step into the fullness and wholeness of what God has created us to be and also created us to do. Amen. So if that resonates with you, I just invite you to stand. Take whatever posture in worship it is that you would like to take to say, this is the time. I have been created for such a time as this. And Jesus, you are worthy. And because you're worthy and you're powerful, those things are going to happen. Because I fix my eyes, I lock my eyes on you, the author and the perfecter of my faith. Thank you, Lord. Fall on me. So gently breathe on, breathe on these dry bones. Fall on me, fall.
Yes, Lord.
Pray these chains and pray these chains. Come and pray, yeah, these chains. Darkness has to flee and break these chains. Bondage has to break and break these chains.
If you can, would you stand with us as we sing this last song? You stood before creation.
eternity in your hand. You spoke the earth into motion. My soul now to stand. You stood before my failure. Carried the cross for my shame. My sin weighed upon your shoulders. My soul now to stand. So what can I say? And what could I do? Offer this heart, O God, completely to you. So I walk upon salvation, your spirit alive in me. This life to declare your promise, my soul now to stand. So I walk upon salvation, your spirit alive in me. This life to declare your promise, my soul now to stand. So what can I say? What could I do? Offer this heart.
Yeah. Give him praise.
Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Jesus.
He is good, amen. So Heavenly Father, we thank you for our time together this morning, and we know that this is just the beginning. We thank you that you're here. You are worthy, God, of worship, worshiping lives, of thanksgiving and praise. Blessing and honor and glory and power. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' living name, amen. Happy Sunday! Yay! So welcome. If this is your first time with us, thank you so much for choosing to worship with us this morning. And if this is your home, that's like the best time ever! That was so awesome. Yeah, it's good to be together. When you came in this morning, you should have received a loop. All of our contact information is in there. Everything that you need to know about what is going on. You can also check out our website and look for that. The only thing to mention this morning is that we do not have upraise tonight. We usually would, but it's not happening this evening. And we will let you know for the next time. We'll probably take a little bit of a hiatus over the summer and then start back up in August. But we'll let you know about that. Bless you guys.
All right, it's my turn. Yay! Ron gets scared when I get the mic, doesn't he? He does. It's so awesome. Okay, so there were two things that the Lord gave me this morning for two people. Are you writing something? Are you in the middle of writing something? No, nothing? Okay, you're going to write something here soon? And no, I'm telling you because I saw you writing it, and the Lord was like, just tell him this. Tell him that whatever he's writing. I was like, I was like, Lord, is it a book? He didn't show me what it was. I was like, is it a contract, a secret, whatever. So whatever it is you're about to write, when you write it, it's going to come to fruition, and it's going to be good, okay? So keep that in context with what the Lord is speaking to you about, okay? Because you may end up writing something. I don't know what it is, but I saw you writing, and that's what he told me. And then somebody else over here, he's a new fellow. Where'd he go? Oh, there he is. Yes, hi. Okay, you were here last week. How are you? This is Brian? Brian. Ryan. Okay, I'll get it right. Brian. Ryan. Okay, Ryan. All right, there we go. Okay, seriously. No, seriously, Ryan. The Lord knows who you are. But I didn't give you a word last week because I really felt like it was for the other gal that was sitting next to you. But the Lord wants you to know this. You've been through a lot of rough patches in your life, some more than others. They've been painful places for you. Okay, but the Lord wants you to know that as you turn that over to him, all those rough places that you've had, all those rough patches that you've had, that you can put those in the past too. Because remember last week, the word for her was keep it in the past. It's for you too. But once those things come, when you get healed of those things, that's the place you're going to have authority in. Because you carry authority already. It's like I see you as a cop or something, or private investigator or something. I don't know if that was a wishful thinking of a long time ago, but that's something that you have on you. So whatever that means for you down the road, when the Lord opens that up, you'll understand. But I just wanted you to know that that's what he spoke to me to tell you. You're a man of authority, and to let those things that once were very painful to you become the very place that when you get healed, you have authority in them. Okay? All right, so thank the Lord for that. Okay, so, all right, next thing. Yes, thank you. You know, the scripture teaches, yeah, I know. See, he hates when I get the mic. It's okay. 1 Timothy 1:18, pop your Bibles open to it real quick. This is a fast little Bible study. And the reason why I'm going to do this is because I gave two gentlemen two words today, right? And sometimes we forget, when you get a prophetic word or somebody speaks something to you that really edifies you, it encourages you, and it comforts you. That's what 1 Corinthians 12 teaches. 12 teaches, yeah. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 teaches it. Prophecy 13, 14. Okay, it's all in there. It teaches that prophecy is for edification, exhortation, and comfort. And when you get a prophetic word, you need to hang on to it. So when you look at what Paul wrote to Timothy, here's what he said to him. He said this. He said, oh, help me out here. He says, yeah, I think I can read mine. It says, this command I entrust to you, Timothy, my son, in accordance with the prophecies previously made concerning you. And then he says this, that by them you fight the good fight, keeping faith and a good conscience, which some have rejected and shipwrecked in regard to their faith. Listen, when you get a prophetic word from the Lord, don't let it go to shipwreck, please. Don't let it go to shipwreck. Okay, that's my word. Okay, feel better? I do. All right. All right. Now, I'm going to transition here for a minute. This is Memorial Day weekend. And I told Ron before we came out, I said, I want to do the offering time. But I wanted to say something about Memorial Day quickly. You know, every week, every time it comes around, it's usually barbecue and hot dogs and all that stuff. But how many of you in the room have had family that have been in the military or you have been in the military? Raise your hand. Okay, look at that. All right, I just want to remind everybody, keep your hand up. Keep your hand up for a minute. Okay, have any of you who have had family in the military, have they fallen for our country? Keep your hand up. Okay, look at that. Fallen for our country means that they've died. Okay, put your hands down. I just want to remind everyone in the room, freedom isn't free. Even our own freedom in Christ was bought and paid with a huge sacrifice. And the freedom that we're about to do in giving to God, that wasn't free either. And you can see all the families in the room who have paid that price so that you can sit here and give an offering to the Lord. It's about honoring. It's about honoring. Your first fruits are about honoring what the Lord has done for you. This is not about paying Ron. It's not about paying the bills in this church. It's about what God has done for you. So I just want to take this moment. So if you have your offering ready, to think about that as you're writing your check. Million is spelled M-I-L-L-I-O-N. Woohoo! It's going to happen one day. There's a kiosk in the back. If you have a debit card and you prefer to go that route, you can do like that and put your digits in and it all gets taken care of for you at the same time. But if you have your offering and you feel comfortable to hold it up, I love you, Craig. You're awesome. Hold it up to the Lord. Father, I thank you. I thank you. I thank you that freedom isn't free. And I thank you for, Lord, what you did on the cross for our freedom, Lord, so that we can give back to you. Father, I thank you for the families of those represented here who have fallen ones, who have fallen for the freedom in this country that we have, that we can live the life that we live in this country because of their sacrifice for each one of us represented here. Lord, I don't ever take that lightly. Father, I thank you for all the families in the military, Lord, who have suffered and suffered through many, many trials for our freedoms in this country. Lord, bless them. Keep them safe. Lord, even now, keep them safe. And bless this offering, God. Father, I pray that every need will be met today because of what you've done for us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
All righty, where's my kitties? Where's my youngins? Oh, sorry, babe. Have you noticed that they turn on the cuteness so they can get the mic? They kind of look at you and go, okay. You're next week. All right, let's pray.
God, thank you for this day and just everything that you bless us with. And just I pray that for who people can't be here, I pray that they get better or whatever's going on. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen. All right, be free. Be free. They're running over, the usher's taking the offering. We've gone a little longer on some things than normal, and I'm going to ask you guys if you would give me some grace today, because remember I told you to be here this week, and for the next 2 weeks we're going to talk about spiritual warfare, and it's a branch off of Philippians, and I'll tell you why in just a minute, okay? So just for a second, stand up, stretch your legs, because you're going to be sitting for a little bit, okay? Just stretch your legs and say hi to somebody. All righty, let's round them back up. Round them back up. All righty, let's have a word of prayer, and we're going to take off. Father, thank you for the worship. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for declaring over us through the prophetic, Lord. Thank you for the freedom you declared over us, and that there's freedom in this house. And Lord, we make up your house. It's not this brick building that we're in. We make up your house. You said we're living stones being built up into a holy place, a spiritual temple. And so, Lord, we declare today that you are here. And Father, we, in Jesus' name, bind the enemy. And the enemy has no authority here because of the blood of Jesus and the name of Jesus. So, Lord, open your word to us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. When Hitler was marching across Europe, I found this very interesting as I found this week. When Hitler was marching across Europe, the majority of the nations and places that he took were not ready and could not battle against him. There were times in the battles where, with the superior technology that the Nazi regime had, and superior weapons, superior soldiers, that the nations and the cities and the places that they took didn't have anywhere near that. There were times where they would throw rocks at Hitler's army, and they would throw sticks, anything they could, because they weren't prepared to meet Hitler in battle. And the same, and I will say, I'm going to make some statements today. The same goes for the body of Christ. Satan has an army. He has a regime that makes Hitler's look like a kindergarten class with toy guns. And we as believers have gotten so complacent and so lax in our walk with Christ and in the fact of realizing that the Bible says that we're in a battle. We're in a battle. And the reason we're in a battle is because Satan is battling against God. His whole point is to discredit Christ, to discredit God. And the way he does that is every believer that he takes down, he can stand in the face of God and say, look. And we as a church, and I'm talking about not just here, Marietta Vineyard Church, but the church at large, the church universal, have got to start realizing something, that we are in a battle. Let me show you something. All right, next slide. Here's a definition. Spiritual warfare. Now, don't look at it. I'm hoping, y'all going, okay, I won't look at it. I'm not looking, okay? I'm hoping today to debunk and demystify a couple of things in spiritual warfare, and I'll tell you about that in a minute. Here's a good definition. Okay, bring it back. Thank you. You are so good. Y'all turn around and say, thank you, Sarah. Okay. Spiritual warfare is resisting, overcoming, and defeating the enemy's lies that he sends our way. And that's it, plain and simple. Look at it again. It's resisting and overcoming and defeating the enemy's lies that he sends our way. Now, to do this, you must question what and who you believe in. To do this, you have to ask yourself, do I believe that I am in the middle of a war for my soul? Do I believe that Satan and demons are real? Or Hollywood? Do I believe God is real and he loves me? These are some questions we have to ask. Then here's the big question we have to ask. And this is where the rubber meets the road. I want you to listen to this question before we get into this. Here's the question. Who is stronger? Don't answer. Because by our life and by what we believe, we answer that question. Who is stronger, God or Satan? And today I'm going to step on your toes. I'm going to get you mad at me, and I'm hoping to. It is my purpose. I want to get you so flaming upset with either me or Satan. Because it's the only way, not out of anger, but out of confrontation. Because let me tell you something, saints, he's real, he hates you, he hates God, he hates everything about God, and his whole purpose is to get you to fall so he can blame God. And stand in the face of God and go, look at Ronnie, look what he did. And you tell me he loves you. Now, we can say all we want. What, you know, Jesus stands there, and it's true. He says he's covered in my blood. There's no accusation that can get him. But why do we have to allow Satan to be able to do that? And I'm not angry today, but I'm passionate about what I'm going to teach you today, okay? Now, you're going, how are you getting this out of Philippians? Well, we're not going to read it today. We're going to read it next week. But in Acts chapter 16, verses 16 through 30, there's a confrontation of light and darkness, God and Satan, Christians and the enemy, where Paul's going to the place of prayer and a demon-possessed fortune-telling woman is walking along behind him going, look, these are men of God. They're here to tell you about God. Look, these are men of God. And Paul gets so uptight and so over this, he turns around and casts the demon out of the girl. She gets free. They go and beat him up. They put him in prison. And then God delivers him from prison miraculously. But then Paul goes back into prison. He doesn't leave. You're going, huh? We'll read it next week. But it is an offshoot. The Philippian church began by a river with getting some ladies saved and their families, and shortly after that, maybe days, there was this confrontation with light and darkness, God and Satan, over a young girl who is a fortune-telling woman. But we're going to see how that applies to us as a church next week. But first I want to go, here's the next slide. We're going to look at God, Satan, and demons. Let me tell you a couple things. I'm going today from the premise that most of us here, if not all of us, believe that God is real and he loves us. So I'm going from that premise today, okay? Hebrews 11:6 says this, and I'm going to go through a lot of scriptures. You just have to write them down, okay? Hebrews 11:6, and without faith it is impossible to please him, for he who comes to God must believe that he is and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him. We have to come from the premise, if we're going to battle the enemy, that we believe that God is real and he loves us. Not just God is real, but that he loves us. You're going, why? Because we can believe God is real. Most unbelievers, most that have never accepted Christ as their Lord and Savior, believe God is real. We're going to see in a minute this, the enemies believe God is real, and they tremble. But here's the key. Not just believing that God is real, but believing that he loves us. Because if we don't believe he loves us, there's room for the enemy attack. And understand when I say this today, the battle is here. This is where the battle is. In the mind. This is where it happens. Because this is where the enemy defeats us by going, you know God doesn't love you. You know he can't stand you. You're a failure. And I'm not prophesying this over you, okay? She's going, I'm new, and why are you doing this to me? Because you're on the front row. Anybody on the front row is fair game. Okay? That's why y'all notice everybody's back that way. Okay? But that's what he wants to do. And as soon as he does that, what happens? We get defeated. And then what do? We pull back from our relationship with God. We pull back from the body of Christ. We pull back from doing the very things that God has asked us to do. Why? Because he's planted the seeds of doubt in our lives. Now watch this. Okay? Believe is a verb. Now, we've gone through this. You guys should know this by heart. It's the word pistuo. And the word pistuo comes from the word pistis in the Greek. And pistis is the word for faith. And pistuo is believe. Why? It means to believe, that faith in. Belief is the action of faith. Faith is the foundation. Believing is the action. We can have faith all we want, and this stage is going to hold up when I set my behind on this thing. But the action to that belief is this, or to that faith is this. I believe enough where I'm sitting down. And it's the same in any aspect of our walk with Christ. Now, let me show you a couple things. I'm going to tell you a couple things. I'm going to give you some names of God. Why? Because in a minute, I'm going to give you some names and titles of Satan. And I'm going to give God a lot more credit than I'm going to give him. But I want us to understand something. Because even in the names of God and the very character of God is our freedom, is our weapons, is what we need to believe in. Let me show you a couple of things. The word Elohim. And for my Hebrew brothers, please forgive me. I may get Yoav to read this, okay? All right? Elohim. It means strong one. It's the plural name for God. So what do we see from just that name? God is what? He's what?
Strong.
Strong, thank you. Okay. Then from that, we have compounds of the word Elohim. We have El Shaddai, which means God Almighty. So from that, what do we understand? He's Almighty. Okay, we have El Elyon, which means what? The Most High God. So which means he's what? He's supreme. So we gather that. We get the word El Olam, which means the everlasting God. He's got no end. He's got no beginning. He's always been. So we understand that about God. Then we have the word Yahweh or Jehovah. Okay, and it means to exist or to be. It also means Lord. So we have some compounds of that. We have Yahweh Jireh, which means the Lord our provider, or literally means the Lord is enough. He's more than enough. So what do we understand? That God can give us more than we could ever imagine. And God is in us more than we can ever imagine. Did you hear that? As believers, God lives in us so mightily. Greater is he that is in than he that is in. See what his name means? Okay, we have another one. We have Yahweh Nisi, or Jehovah Nisi, when the Lord is my banner. Okay? We have, you know what a banner was for? Someone tell me. Anybody know? You're going, I'm not answering nothing today. Okay? Banner, they would hold the banner up. It was a declaration of who they were. The tribes would have a banner, and they would rally around that banner. And they would hold it up, and then when the tribes would separate, they would hold that banner up, and it declared who they were. It declared that they were Jewish from the tribe of Benjamin and that God was their God. It was a declaration. Most of us don't declare the things of God anymore because why? We think we're being a little radical. I mean, we ought to find somebody at least once a day and declare the goodness of God in our lives. Even if it's some person on the street, you just grab them and freak them out. I mean, they might get saved. You never know. You know, just walk up to them and go, God is so good to me, man. He loves me so much. I mean, I can't get over it. It's huge. God is big. I'm small. And he takes care of me. Isn't it wonderful? Then when they die, you can raise them up. And then you got a whole revival going on. Okay? So we should do that. Jehovah Shalom, which means the Lord is my peace, the Lord of peace. We wonder so much, you know, we have such this restlessness in our hearts and lives, but God is a God of peace. And if he's a God of peace, then why are we restless? Who's bigger? Who's stronger? Jehovah Sabaoth, which means the Lord of hosts. Did I say that right? Oh, thanks. Mike, please. No, I'm not trying to, you know, ridicule. Say it again.
It's Yahweh Tzevaot.
Yeah, okay. And what does it mean? Translate it.
The Lord God of hosts.
Thank you. It means that. It's said that way. There's nothing worse than a goyim trying to do Hebrew here. Okay? Yahweh Shema? Okay, yeah. Means the Lord is here and there. Okay? It really does. Adonai, one of my favorite. I love that name, Adonai. Okay, it's like Elohim, it's plural. It means majesty, it means owner, it means master, it means Lord. These are some of the names. If you want that list, I'll be happy to email you, okay? I'll send it to you. There's even more. There's actually another second page to it. But these are the names of God, and in his name we find our hope. By his name we're saved. He was in the Old Testament, he was mighty. In the New Testament, he's just as mighty. Now let me show you something. All right? Now, we're going to transition from that. Keep those names in mind because we're going to talk about them in a minute. But somewhere between Genesis chapter 1, verse 31, when God ended and he said everything he made was good, somewhere between that and Genesis 3:1, there was a battle in heaven where Satan himself, or Lucifer at that time, rebelled against God. And somewhere in there, there was the fall. And we'll see in a minute if we read that. You can see, I think it's in Ezekiel, where it says that Lucifer was in the Garden of Eden. Why was he there? Because he was there to tempt. Because his whole purpose is he didn't get his way in heaven. He wanted to be above God. He wanted to be as powerful as God. He wanted to ascend higher than God. And we're going to see that in a minute. And when he didn't get that, when God expelled him out of heaven, it says in Revelation that the dragon took his tail and he swiped a third of the angel, the heavenly host, and took them with him. Thus we have our demons. Satan's names. First one is Satan. It's Hebrew. It means adversary. It's used in the New Testament. It's just transliterated into the New Testament same way. It means adversary. Job chapter 1, verse 6. 1 Chronicles chapter 21, verse 1. That's just a couple of places. We have the name or the title devil. It's only used in the New Testament. It's the word diablos. It means the accuser, false accuser, one who divides. give you the scriptures another time. The serpent in Genesis chapter 3, verse 1, all the way down to Revelation chapter 20, verse 2. There's many places he's called the serpent. It means this. It means one who eyes is objective, attentively. Isn't that interesting? That means, and I'm not trying to scare anybody. I want us to get to reality. It means he's watching all the time. He's looking. He's looking. And he's always looking. Don't lose me today. Because today, a spirit of slumber is going to want to get on you. And you want to go to sleep. And you want to get a rest. Don't do it. Okay? Fight. Another name, Beelzebub. It means Lord of the Flies, or it means the fly god. My wife, I'm going to tell you a funny story. She's going to get mad. Every time she goes around and there's some flies, she goes, "Oh, Beelzebub, get away in Jesus' name." And I'm going, "Shh." She goes, "I don't care. Lord of flies, be gone in Jesus' name." And somehow the flies go, "Ee." Don't you wish you had that kind of authority? And so it means Lord of the Flies or Lord of the Dung Heap. Isn't that interesting? Lord of the Poop Pile. I'm not trying to be funny, but that's what it means, okay? That's exactly what it means. And he stinks. Another one, he's called the ruler of this world. John 12, 31, 14, 30, and 16, 11. Three times Jesus calls him the ruler of this world. He's called the prince of the power of the air, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 2. He's called the evil one in Matthew 13, verse 19. Now, let me show you something. His sin. Turn with me to Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 14. Start in verse 12. Now, this is a word, a prophetic word that was given over to Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon. But we all can see and you'll understand that it was also a prophetic word declaring what happened with Satan. Watch this. "How you have fallen from heaven, O star of the morning, son of the dawn." Verse 12. "You have been cut down to the earth. You have weakened the nations. But you said in your heart, 'I will ascend to heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God, and I will sit on the mount of the assembly in the recesses of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. Nevertheless, you will be thrust down to Sheol, to the recesses of the pit. Those who see you will gaze at you. They will ponder over you, saying, 'Is this the man who made the earth tremble, who shook the kingdoms?'" You see what's going on here? Now turn with me to Ezekiel. Ezekiel chapter 28. Just over a few books. Ezekiel 28, look at verse 11. Now we saw what his sin was what? It was rebellion bathed in pride. It was attempting to be equal to God in status and authority. Now watch this. Verse 11. "Again, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, 'Son of man, take up a lamentation over the king of Tyre and say to him, Thus says the Lord God, you had the seal of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering, the ruby, the topaz, the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, the jasper, the lapis, the lazuli, the turquoise and the emerald, and the gold, the workmanship of your settings and sockets." Now, it's interesting. In the settings and sockets, it means several things. Sockets also means flutes, musical instruments. Okay? And the settings means harps. His body, from what we understand, from what we can gather, Satan's body was a musical instrument in some way, shape, or form. And when he would move, it would praise. His whole body would praise God. It says that he was a covering cherub, which means that his wings would stand out like this, and it would reflect the glory of God in heaven. So no wonder Satan has perverted music. No wonder he attacks worship leaders, because he was the worship leader, from what we understand, most likely of heaven. No wonder his pride began to take over, because it happens to musicians. You get a bunch of musicians in the room? The bass player's fighting with the drummer. The guitar player's fighting with the sound guy to turn his stuff down. The keyboard player just can't stand everybody. And the lead singer has lead singer syndrome, which means it's all about me. It's called LSS, lead singer syndrome. You know, there's MS, there's all these diseases, and there's LSS. Okay, I told you I'm going to offend everybody today. All right, I can do this. I'm a musician. I'm a guitar player. We like to be heard, especially when we turn the distortion pedals on. So no wonder that Satan would battle against musicians and music. But he battles against everything. Keep reading. Watch this. Look at verse 14. You are the anointed cherub who covers, who guards, who reflects, and I placed you there. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked in the midst of the stones of fire. You were blameless in your ways from the day you were created until unrighteousness was found in you. And by the abundance of your trade, you were internally filled with violence and you sinned. Therefore, I have cast you as profane from the mountain of God, and I have destroyed you, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. You corrupted your wisdom by reason of your splendor. I cast you to the ground. I put you before kings that they may see you. See what's going on? Demons went with him. There was a rebellion in heaven. How can we explain this? Stand in line with all the theologians that are trying to explain this over the years. There's just some things we don't know. But rest of heaven, from what we understand, is now sealed. There can be no more rebellion. The demons, a third, went with him in Revelation chapter 12, verse 4. These are angels who sinned against God and who now continually work evil in the world. That's from Wayne Grudem in Systematic Theology. It's a great study he did on it. And I just gave you just two lines synopsis. Demons are evil angels, fallen angels, who sin against God and who continually work evil in the world. Now, they're held in limitations. Now, listen to me. Don't lose me. Stay with me, okay? In Job chapter 1, verse 12, Satan had to ask permission to even do anything to Job. God allowed him. Why? It's another study. The same in chapter 2, verse 6. And then in Jude 6, it says that demons are held in chains. Now, from what we understand, we can say they're chained in hell and they're waiting down there. I don't think so, and neither do a number of theologians. The chains means limitations. They can do just so much. You put a pair of handcuffs or chains on somebody, it limits their mobility and limits what they can do. So even in that, God is sovereign and God is powerful. Now, let's look at a couple things. Go to the next slide. Ways and purpose and targets. I'm going to show you a couple things. In Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 14, and also in Revelation 12, 10, because of time, we're not going to read them, because we're going to read some others, okay? There's three ways, main ways, that Satan attacks and tempts, okay? Through deception. In 2 Corinthians 11, verse 1 through 3, it says, Eve was deceived by the enemy. I'm going to show you how in just a moment. It says she was deceived by the enemy. It wasn't Adam at first, it was Eve. It's not knocking women, so don't go there. Don't let the enemy do that. Because he was stupid, Adam. Okay? He wasn't just deceived, he was deceived and stupid. Okay? And if stupid's in the Bible, I can say that. Okay? And then Adam succumbed to what Eve said and listened and ate, and that's when the fall happened. But it says that Eve was deceived by Satan himself. Then there's another way. There's temptation. There's deception. There's temptation. Luke chapter 4, verse 2, it says that Jesus was taken out into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. We're going to look at tempted in just a minute. Okay? So he tempted Christ. He deceived Eve. He tempted Christ. And then Revelation chapter 12, verse 10, it says he stands before God day and night and accuses the believers before God. So he's the accuser. It's accusation. Deception, temptation, and accusation. This is how the enemy fights. You ever been there? You ever gotten deceived, or I call it duped, by the enemy? I've used this illustration before. When I was in Bible college, I won't name the one to disgrace it, but I was in Bible college as a young man, and one of the things that was starting to go around, a deception that was going around among the guys and girls, is that if you loved each other, you can have sex with each other. This is in Bible college. And many kids were getting thrown out. But they were believing it. And there was others that were going, no, this is wrong. You know that. No, no, listen. If we're going to get married and we love each other and we're devoted to each other, it's okay. It was a deception. And then what did it lead to? It led to temptation. The acting it out. And then the last thing it led to was what? Accusation. Because when they finally realized what was going on, then the guilt and everything else started coming. Satan's going, see, you screwed up. See, you messed up. See what happened? See what happened? Look what you did. You're no good. We've all been there. You're going, how do we battle this? I'll show you in a minute. Then his purpose is this. His ways of getting at us is deception, temptation, accusation. And his purpose is this. Turn to John 10:10. John 10:10. Look at this. Look at verse 7. Let's start in verse 7. So Jesus said to them again, truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door or the gate of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers. But the sheep did not hear them. I am the gate, or I'm the door. If anyone enters through me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. So his purpose is to steal, kill, and destroy. Steal what? There's all kinds of things. I'm going to give you a couple things for steal. He wants to steal your joy and your peace. There's nothing worse than a depressed believer. Think about it. Because if God came to give us life and life abundantly, and he says, Christ says, I am your joy, then what does the enemy want to steal? If he can steal our joy, it moves us into depression, and then he absolutely has got us defeated. Because why? We're not going to try anything. We're not going to be a threat to darkness. We're not going to be a threat to the kingdom of the enemy. We're not going to be any of that. If he gets us bummed out, he steals our joy, what happens? Okay, so look, he steals our joy and our peace, and then he wants to kill our witness for Christ. If he can kill our witness for Christ, who's going to listen to us? And what does it do? Bam! It's a shot. It's damage to the kingdom of God. Because remember this, his whole purpose is to battle and destroy the kingdom of God. And the sad part about it is this, Satan knows that he is defeated. And there's nothing, and I can tell you this from practical real life experience, there's nothing worse than fighting somebody who knows they're going to lose because they fight harder. And they will go down. It's the old saying. I was in a fight one time. I'm not proud of this, but I'm going to use the illustration. And there were several guys, and it was just me. And a guy goes, we're going to take you out. And me, as cocky as I was, even though I got my butt royally beat, like in the movie Star Trek, it was an epic beating. But I looked at him and said, but you and you are going with me. And then it was over real quick. But you see the point? I knew I was defeated. But I wanted to make sure that I took him and him damaged with me. And yes, I did. Anyways, But understand what the enemy, it's a fight. It was a fight. I'm not proud of it. I laugh about it now because it was stupid, arrogant, and I was a youth. And I was brain dead. But the fact is this, is that Satan does the same thing. He knows he's lost. He knows he's not going to win. But he's going to fight all the harder. And he's going to take you. He's going to take you. He's going to take anyone he can take. He's going to take with us. And he wants us dead. Why? Look at the next thing. Comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. If he can destroy our life and our walk in Christ, if he can destroy the very works of God in our life, he thinks he's won. But grace covers that. But can you see grace in the middle of depression? Most of the time, no. Let's be real. When you're bummed out, you feel like it's all over with, it's all done, can you see the grace of God and go, I see the grace of God, I'm going to be free again? No. We're bummed out. We're walking around going, oh, God, why? You hate me. I know you don't love me anymore. No. And Satan's laughing, a maniacal laugh. Ways, deception, temptation, accusation, purpose, to steal, to kill, to destroy. His target, here we go. Turn to 1 John chapter 2, verse 16. Still with me? Okay. So I will not apologize for this today. And if we go a few minutes, can we handle that? Okay. All right. 1 John chapter 2, verse 16. Let's look at 15. Let's read in context. Do not love the world nor the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the boastful pride of life is not from the Father, but is from the world. The world is passing away, and also its lust, but the one who does the will of God lives forever. Now look at verse 16 again. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the boastful pride of life. Now let me show you something. Turn with me to, keep your finger there, turn with me to Luke. Say it, Luke. Good. I am your father. Sorry, had to do it. Yeah. Yeah, if you hear that kind of voices, I am the father, you're going to hear. Okay? Now look with me. Verse 1, chapter 4 of Luke. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led around by the Spirit in the wilderness for 40 days, being tempted by the devil, and he ate nothing during those days. And when they had ended, he became hungry. Now look at this. And the devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, tell this stone to be made bread. And Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone. Now stop. Keep your finger there. Flip back over into 1 John again. I want you to see this. Look at verse 16. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh. What was he tempting Jesus with? Lust of the flesh. He was hungry. But it's not about hunger that way. Because why? What? He was supposed to be fasting, right? The Spirit, Holy Spirit, was leading him in fasting. There was a purpose for this. So Satan was trying to destroy the very purpose of what God was trying to do and tempt Christ himself with something that was very dear to him because he was hungry. And what if he would have fallen there, if he would have given in, what would happen? He would have given in to the passion to his flesh instead of the purpose of God. See the point? Turn back to Luke. Verse 6, and the devil said to him, I will give you, well, let's go back up to 5. And he led him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said to him, I will give you all this domain and its glory, for it has been handed over to me, and I can give it to whomever I wish. Therefore, if you worship before me, it shall all be yours. And Jesus answered him, it is written, or it stands written, it says literally, you shall worship the Lord your God and serve him only. What was he tempting him with there? Turn back to 1 John. Lust of the eyes. Because why? He showed him all the kingdoms. And he said, I can give them to you. Could he give them to him? Yes. Yes. Who is the ruler of the world? In the temporal world right now, could he have given it to him? Yes, he could have. Absolutely. He was telling a truth, a half-truth. He goes, they were given to me, and I can give them to you. Told you I was going to offend you. Look it up. Before you question it, look it up. He could have given it to him. Temporally, yes. What is he tempting? Is he tempting the God side of Christ, or is he tempting the man? The man. He's tempting the very human side of Christ. I can give you all this. It's the same thing, I'm going to say this, it's the same thing that rock and roll stars are tempted with. I can give you all of this stuff. You just worship me. You do what I want you to do. It's the same thing that we all get. So look at the next thing. Don't lose it. Don't go to sleep on me. Okay? Look at the last thing. The pride of life. Watch what he says. And he led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you, and on their hands they will bear you up so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. And Jesus answered him and said, it is said, or it stands written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. Turn back to 1 John. He tempted him with what? The pride of life. Literally means this. The word pride of life in the Greek means this, arrogant assumption. And for Jesus to display his Godhead, you know, his deity, by jumping off and floating down and not stumbling off the highest point in Jerusalem, it was arrogant assumption. That's not what the Father had for him. Those are the three areas, the target areas, the flesh, the eyes, and the pride of life. And when he tempts us in those areas, when we follow one of those things, what happens is all the other stuff starts happening. It's a snowball. We feel deceived. We got deceived. We're tempted. We feel the accusations. Our joy is stolen. Our witness for Christ is killed. And then eventually there's some that have gone so far to even take their life. This is a war. And there's no way for me to do it all in just one message to give you all this stuff. But I'm giving you enough to make you want to search this out and to look it up. We are in a war. It's not going to be done by Colt 45s, by swords, by any of this stuff. I'm going to show you how it's done in just a second. But it's a war, and the whole thing is for you. He wants to destroy the body of Christ. Those that are in Christ and keep unbelievers, those that don't know Christ, away. And how does he do it? By destroying their walk with Christ, by deceiving them that they can do things that is not pleasing to God, that is sin, and get the church to walk in sin, to get them to like entertainment more than we like the Word of God, to like, you know, being feel good more than we like to truly worship. Because most, and I'll say this, and it's not knocking anybody, but much of what goes on Sunday mornings is just a feel-good entertainment somewhere. Because why? If you don't walk out with an accountable life before God and wanting to be accountable to him and wanting to, as it says in Colossians, to put off the things of the flesh and put on the things of the Spirit, Colossians chapter 3, then what good than coming? We could go to a Steely Dan conference and feel just as good. We can turn on a movie and watch The Last Samurai or whatever. Where did that come from? I don't know. We could watch a movie and feel good and feel just as encouraged and everything else. Why? Because everything is good at the end. Here we go. Next slide. Our defense is this. Our defense is offense. Turn with me, 1 Corinthians chapter 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Look at verse 13. Verse 13, no temptation has overtaken you, but such as is common to man. And God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will provide the way of escape also, so that you will be able to endure it. The first thing is we got to understand something. You know what our greatest offense is? Understanding. Knowing. Understanding this, that God, every temptation that comes our way, no matter what it is, no matter what it is, from drugs to porn to murder to whatever. Pick one. Think about the one that you have the toughest time standing against. And that is common to man. Everything Jesus was tempted with was common to man. The three things that he tempted Jesus with is the exact three things that he tempts us. They're called the big guns. And there's nothing that we can't overcome in Christ. And that's the understanding. We got to believe that when we're tempted, no matter what it may be, God knows that we can overcome it because he's given us a way to overcome it. And he's actually provided, says he's given us a way out. There's a way to walk away. Saints, that's why when I tell people, you know, about coming out of drugs or coming out of porn or coming out of this, it's not hard. We believe it's hard. Doesn't make it easy, but we think it's like it's hopeless. How are we going to get out of this? Christ died on the cross to give us hope, to give us the power, to give us everything we need for life and godliness. And he's given us the weapons to fight against the enemy. And the first one is understanding. Why all through the scriptures does it say in Philippians, Colossians, Ephesians, first, all through the epistles, it says that we are gaining the knowledge of Christ. Being in Christ, we gain knowledge of God. Why? Knowledge is not a bad thing. Nowadays, you just want the feeling. Oh, I want your presence. I want your presence. Oh, give me a feeling. Give me a feeling. And most of those Christians, you walk down, you ask them how to get saved. They can't tell you. But they know about the presence of God. It's all about your presence. It's not. There's times you're not going to feel the presence of God. So what happens is in those moments, most believers crash and burn. Because we run on feelings and you can't. The feelings are the beauty of it. But it's the fact, the understanding of what God's word says, what he told us in here, the weapons he's given us, and this is one of them. And let me show you something. Knowledge or understanding is one. Let me show you a couple of things real quick. Oh, hallelujah. Yeah, I'm gonna. The second thing is we have been given authority over the enemy. Turn to Luke. Don't say it. Luke chapter 10. Weren't we just there? Yep. Bible drill Sunday. Every Sunday is Bible drill Sunday. Luke chapter 10, look at verse 19. Let's look at verse 17. The 70 returned with joy, saying, Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name. He sent out 72, okay? 72, he sent them out. Or 70, excuse me. He sent out 70, and he sent them out in pairs. And he said, go and cast out demons and heal the sick. Don't take anything with you, on and on and on. They come back after this journey. They sent them out in twos, and they come back, and they're just as happy as can be. And they're just, whoa! I mean, look, Lord, look what it says. Look what it says, Luke chapter 10. And the 70 came back, and they said, Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name. And he said to them, I was watching Satan fall from heaven like lightning. Where do we read that earlier? Ezekiel. Behold, I've given you authority to tread on the serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing will injure you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, that the spirits are subject to you, but rejoice that your names are recorded in heaven. And at that very time, he rejoiced greatly in the Holy Spirit. That means Jesus began to dance. The 72 were standing, he got so happy because of what happened with him. He danced. That means to twirl with joy as he was praying. He was dancing and praying at the same time. But the fact is, he tells him, I've given you authority over the enemy. Here's where we got to understand something. Wish I had one of my swords today. We've got to understand this, that you as a believer are the most powerful being on this earth. Think about it. In being in Christ, there's nothing more powerful on this earth than a believer who knows who they are in Christ, who knows what they have in Christ, who walks in what's been given to them in Christ, and does it on a daily basis. Doesn't mean you don't have your moments. We're going to have our moments. As long as we're in this earthly temple, in this flesh that Paul calls it, we're going to have rough times. But when we understand who we are and we walk in that, it's the scariest thing on this earth. And the most powerful thing. I used to have a teacher that says, yes, I am the believer that Satan warned you about. I used to love to wear that. People go, what does that mean? Let me tell you. And I made them all for my youth group. And it was our church t-shirt. It actually said, I am the Christian the devil warned you about. And that's exactly what it is. Satan doesn't like believers who know who they are in Christ. Why? Because they're a threat. We've been given authority. Turn to Mark chapter 16. We've read this before. We actually did a study on this when we talked about casting out demons once before. Mark chapter 16, start in verse 17. These signs will accompany those who have believed. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will pick up serpents, all this other kind of stuff. Okay? It's great. But the thing is, they will cast out demons, which means what? We have authority. You have authority over the enemy. That means Corey can cast the enemy out. That means all of us, every one of us that know Christ, we can cast the enemy out of our own lives and out of the lives of others. We walk with healing in our hands, the word of God on our lips. We're supposed to change the atmosphere when we walk into a room because of who we are in Christ. Imagine that. Let me tell you a story. This is one of the things where I learned and I was wonderfully humiliated publicly. I may have told this story before. I was in Bible college, and me and my roommate named Scott McCracken, Scott, if you're watching, God bless you, you taught me a lot. He was about this big, and he was full of juice all the time, just, you know, for Jesus. He wasn't scared of anything. He knew who he was in Christ, and him and I used to go out into the roughest parts of town and go share Christ with people. We're walking out of our dorm. And between our dorm and the cafeteria for the school, because it was our dorm was just an old apartment building the school bought, we had to walk about a mile to get to the cafeteria. And in between there was several used car lots. So we're walking along, and all of a sudden, these two guys come out from behind a car. And they step out in front of us. One guy was pretty big. He was bigger than I was. The other guy was like probably about my height. And they walk in there. And you can tell immediately they were stoned. You know, we're walking by and he goes, hey! Because they were wanting to pick a fight. You know. He goes, what are you doing? He's doing this. Which is the stupidest thing to do. It's like, oh, hit me right here. And so he's going, Wait. And so I took Scott and did this, because Scott's little. You know, and my first instinct was, okay, he's over there, what am I going to do? You know, it starts going through my head. So I'm moving behind here. And I said, listen, we don't want any trouble. He goes, well, maybe we do. And then I said, you want some trouble? Let's go. And Scott goes, no, brother! And he steps out in between me and this guy. This guy was taller than I am. Scott's this big. Scott's looking at him like this with a finger. And he goes, no, there's no reason for this, brother, because Jesus loves you. And Jesus is here. You know? And I'm looking at the other guy waiting to see if he's going to pull any weapons out. You know? And the big guy standing there, he's looking at Scott like this, and he goes, what'd you say? And he goes, Jesus is here and Jesus loves you. He goes, I don't want to fight Jesus, man. There's no way. I don't want to fight Jesus. And he goes, cool. He goes, you guys go on and go. And Scott looks at me and goes, that's all we need, brother. And I'm walking away going, oh, crap, what a slime ball I am. I can't believe it. I'm trying to protect him and he's showing me up and getting all spiritual on me and everything. Yeah. But it was one of those things where, you know, instantly the flesh wanted to take over, but the spirit was thrown behind. But Scott brought the Holy Spirit in. And it taught me a great lesson. Here's Scott, this little skinny dude, in Jesus' name, stood against what the enemy wanted to do that night by just saying, Jesus loves you and Jesus is here. And that big guy said, I don't want to fight Jesus. It's knowing who we are. Imagine. D.L. Moody said, the world has not yet seen what God can do with one man or woman who's totally sold out to him. We've been given authority over the enemy. Third thing, our defense, is we have been given weapons and an armor. Turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. You guys bored yet? Good. Good. I'm not stopping. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Start in verse 3. 2 Corinthians 10, verse 3. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war. Means we do not make war. We do not fight as a soldier according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but divinely powerful. You know what divinely powerful means in the Greek? Divinely powerful. It really does. Not trying to be sorry. It means God dynamite. Okay? For the destruction of fortresses. The word fortress, take your pen and circle fortress in your Bible. The word fortress means to fortify. It means a protected area. A protected area. You know what that is? Anything we are trying to keep and hide from God. That, this is not condemnation, that secret sin, that thing that we struggle with, that we just can't seem to get over, and we can't seem to get over because we don't think we can get over it. It's a fortress. It's standing up. It's a rock-solid wall that's encased this thing, whatever it may be. So look what it says, destruction of fortresses. We are destroying, means we are obliterating speculations. Speculation is anything, any thought, any statement, anything in here that's hostile to the Christian faith. It means any decision, any judgment. It means any lie. We are destroying those speculations and every lofty thing. A lofty thing means a barrier, a rampart. It means a way that gets over our defenses. That makes sense? Whatever can get over or get around our defenses, we're destroying those things. Anything that's raised up against the knowledge of God, the knowledge is gnosis. It's not epigenosis, it's gnosis, which means a fragment present understanding or knowledge. The knowledge of God, and we are taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. The word captive means to take away with a weapon, to take away with a spear. So what does this mean? It means in Christ, if I'm in Christ and he's in me, I'm seated in Christ in the heavenly realms with Christ. It means I'm literally seated in him. It says in Ephesians 2:6. That means I'm in him and he's in me. So that means the very presence of God is in my life. And in that, by his word, which we'll see in a minute, I can take captive these thoughts. Because what does it say in Romans chapter 12, verse 1? I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your spiritual worship. What's verse 2? Be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Where does the battle happen? Here. This is where the defeat happens. You can beat somebody to almost to death. If they know that they're right, you can't beat that out of them. Christians would go to the lions, go to being burnt, going to be beheaded, and it didn't matter. Why? Because they knew what was true, and they stood on what was true. You can kill me, but you're not going to stop the gospel because I know it's right. And they would willingly go to death because of something. Because of the faith, because of the gospel. When a person knows something, you can't get it out of them. You try to convince me God's not real and it's not going to work. You try to tell me I'm not called to preach and I'm the worst preacher in the world, I hurt my feelings, but it's not going to work. Why? Because I know what God said in my life. I know who I am. I know where I'm going. And when we have that, that defeats the fortresses. That defeats the speculations. That defeats the lofty things. That defeats all this stuff that stands itself against the knowledge of God. Which means what? The very things that God wants to do in my life. Because when we have knowledge, we have understanding. We have understanding, we step out in faith and we believe. Does that make sense? Okay, you're going, is this ever going to end? No. Okay. Now, turn to Ephesians chapter 6. We're winding it down. Here we go. You know we had to go to Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 6. Let me show you something. So, we have been given weapons. They're divinely powerful. Let's look at those weapons. Finally, verse 10. Not finally, we're getting done. Finally, that's what it says. Verse 10, finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the full armor of God so that you will be able to stand firm against the schemes of the devil. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the full armor of God so that you will be able to resist in the evil day and have done everything to stand firm. Now let me show you something. Then it goes on and describes the armor. But we don't have time today to go through each one of those things, but look through it. Every piece of armor describes Christ. Every piece. Every piece. So if we're in Christ, who do we put on? Exactly. Now, who's the one that defeats the enemy? Who's our main weapon? See the point? Everything that he is. He's our faith. He's our righteousness. He's our peace. He's our the Logos, the sword. It says out of his mouth in Revelation, there's a sword that comes out. What is it? His word. Who is the word? Christ. So who battles the enemy? Who are we battling with? Christ. What did Christ, how did he battle the enemy? By quoting the word of God. You're going, but sometimes it doesn't work. I don't feel it. Quit with the stinking feelings all the time. It's not about whether you feel it or not. It's a fact. You're more than an overcomer. You've got the weapons that defeats the enemy. You're bigger and badder than Satan. That's not an arrogance. Greater is he that's in you than he is in the world. So who's the big guy? You see? Whose spirit lives within you? Christ. Who's your daddy? God, you laughed. It caught your attention, didn't it? Think about it. What does a little kid do? He runs to his dad when he's in trouble like that. So who's your daddy? Who wins? See, you know the end of it all. We win. But it doesn't make the battle any easier. Let me show you something real quick. Look at something. Look at verse 11. Put on the full armor of God so that you will be able to stand against the schemes of the enemy. Now, let's keep going. Let me show you something here real quick. Okay? For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. Another. Look at verse 13. Therefore, take up the full armor of God so that you will be able to resist in the evil day and having done everything to stand firm. Now, there's four stands, and we've gone through this, okay, before. But I want to tell you this real quick. The first stand means to hold fast. It means this. I've used this illustration before. It's a fighting stance. That's exactly what Paul is describing because he's seen the Roman soldiers do this. You ever seen a, let's look at football. When the line comes up, what do they do when the guy, when the quarterback walks up and he flips the towel over the guy's back and he goes, and he goes like this. What does the team do? They get down in their stance, right? And they wait. What does a fighter do when they come in and they go to do the toe-to-toe Rocky thing, like go for it, you know, and all that stuff. And then they go back to their corner, and the bell goes ding, and the ref does this, and they come out, and they come out. What do? They walk out and go, hey, what's up? Good to see you. No. They walk out and they do what? And they get in their stance and they're doing it and they're bouncing. It's called a fighting stance. That's exactly what this is. It's an attitude of heart. It's an attitude of mind. We need to be consistently in a fighting stance against the enemy. When we're out in the world, you got to be aware of what's going on. Because it says in James that the enemy walks around. He roams around. He prowls around, it says, like a roaring lion seeking who he's going to devour. That means he's watching. He's waiting for that one moment where you drop your hands. I'm going to tell something on my wife. She studied martial arts with me for a while. And there was like three girls in the class. She's going, I can't believe he's going to tell this story. But it's a perfect illustration. There's three girls in the class. She was the oldest lady in the class. Okay? I was the oldest guy. They called us grandma and grandpa. I was in my late 30s. She was in her early 30s. And there was this 18-year-old redhead, fiery, another Latin girl. Very fiery. And so we paired off to spar one day. So I was teaching with the Sifu that day, so I didn't get to fight. So Sifu goes, Denise, and I forgot what her name was. We called her Frank. we called her Red. That's right, we did call her Red. So he goes, Denise and Red, you guys, and he's pairing up. So she's, Denise, hey, good to see you. I'll go. Let's have some fun. We're going to spar. Yeah. And Red came in like this. And so Sifu goes, okay, all right, go. So, him and I are walking around. And so I'm walking by and Sifu's standing next to me. And all of a sudden, Red goes, bam, and rocks Denise's head back. And Denise goes, easy. And Sifu goes, I started go over. And Sifu goes, no, wait. And so Denise goes, okay, come on. And she goes, yeah, and her bounce around, yeah. And, Denise dropped her hands. And Red goes, bam, and rocks Denise's head. And all of a sudden, I saw the look. And Sifu started to go in, and I went, no, wait. And he goes, oh, yeah. And Denise goes, take it easy. Denise drops her hands. Boom! And Red rocks her head. And she goes, that's the way you want to do it? Let's go. So Red starts going. And Red goes like this, and Denise goes, bam, and lays her out on the mat, mounts her, grabs the back of her head, and does this. And she goes, are we done? And Red goes, yeah. And Sifu goes, ding, winner. Why did I use illustration? Not to embarrass my wife, but to tell you that's exactly what happens. The moment we drop our guard and compromise our walk with Christ in any way, shape, or form, our hands go down. And when our hands drop, the enemy's standing there waiting for that one moment, and he just pow! And he hits us and takes us out. You're saying, but do we have to live that? It's not this intensive walk. Okay, I got to stay in Christ. I got to stay in Christ. I got to stay in Christ. It's knowing I am in Christ. And my life is his, and my life is given to him, and he's the one that I serve, and he's the one who is my life. We are told to hold fast our walk. This is no compromise. Our fighting stance is knowing that we're in Christ. We don't walk around, work like this. Because then you're going to get thrown out and get fired. But this is the attitude, knowing that when we're out there, the enemy wants to take us out. I knew when after I got saved, if I wasn't aware of what was going on, I would have gone right back into drugs again. I was a youth pastor at a church. It's the last story, and we're going to end this. I was a youth pastor at a church, and it was a church that Kelly and her family were at. And I am no handsome guy by any stretch of the imagination, but back then I looked like Barry Gibb from the Bee Gees, had the beard, staying alive, whatever. So, but that didn't make any difference. But anyways, I'm in Baptist church. We have Wednesday night supper. And so the supper was there in the tables and we were in the gym, and I was waiting for us all to get done because the kids would come in. We'd take the stuff up, we'd sweep the floor, and then we had our youth meeting. And we're getting stuff ready. So I'm walking along. As I'm walking in between these tables, this lady reaches out and grabs my belt right there in front of everybody. And she jiggles my pants. And she goes, I'm going to say it this way. She goes, what's in there? And said, in Jesus' name, nothing you will ever know, and that is foul. And I pushed her hand away, and I walked away. But that is how preachers fall that quick. But my guard was up. I was ready. This is what happens every day. It's not to scare us. It's to let us know that we're in a war, and the war is about you and about me. He wants to discredit and take us out. And I wasn't trying to be gross with that story. This is, you know, we always say, get authentic and real. Okay, here's authentic and real. This happens every day. It happens in the workplace. There's those temptations, and the enemy's going to find every weak point, because a fighter looks for the weak. He sees that there's a damage, and a fighter will look, and he'll pound that damage till it totally weakens the opponent. And he's going to hit every time in there. He sees you're holding a rib. As soon as your hand goes up, he's going to, bam, he's going to hit that rib. He's going to do everything he can to take us out. And that's what Satan does. He's not stupid. You know, I got the enemy under my feet. Ooh, ooh, ooh. And he's laughing. That's mocking the enemy. You never mock your opponent. You respect them. Because you don't know what they can do. Most of us want to scream in warfare, you know, we're going to take down the heavenly hosts and territorial spirits and all that kind of stuff. That's stupid. Do you know that the territorial spirits over areas, who allows them to be there? God. So why are we going to fight against him? Nowhere did Jesus ever walk into a town and command the territorial spirits off of that town. He came in and did what? He won the town one person at a time. Let me show you something. Next slide. I'm a child of God, born again, Holy Spirit filled, and seated with Christ in heavenly places. I'm surrendered to and captured by Christ, filled with his love, dedicated to him and furthering his kingdom. In Christ, I am set apart, consecrated, purchased, filled with his purpose and set in motion by his power. I am part of the people of God. I acknowledge that I am in a spiritual battle, and the battle is real. The battle is not with flesh and blood, but with Satan and his demonic forces. Yet I am more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus, and I stand victorious in him. Today I make this declaration in and through Jesus Christ that I will no longer be bound by the lies, deceptions, accusations of the enemy. I know the truth, and his name is Jesus. I will face temptations from my position in Christ and with the word of God. I renounce and repent for believing the lie that Satan is stronger than God. I reject darkness and the ways of this world and choose his life, and by his grace and power will live in his light. With this declaration, I make my stand, and here I will stand. For me to live is Christ, for Christ is my life. Amen. You want to say that with me? Stand up. Stand up. Now I'm going to ask you, don't say this if you don't believe it. Don't say this if you're going to go and not try in Christ and strive in Christ to do it. Because why? You're going to make a vow to God. This is a promise. It's a declaration. It's telling the enemy that this is where I stand. You know what this is? Is picking a fight. Don't say it if you're not going to live it. Doesn't mean you won't have your times. Doesn't mean that you may not fall in some way. But don't say this if you're not going to live it. I'm being very serious. You don't see me this serious too much. But this is not a game. This is not a game. Here we go. I am a child of God, born again, Holy Spirit filled, and seated with Christ in the heavenly places. I am surrendered to and captured by Christ, filled with his love, dedicated to him, and furthering his kingdom. In Christ, I am set apart, consecrated, purchased, filled with his purpose, and set in motion by his power. I am part of the people of God. I acknowledge that I am in a spiritual battle, and the battle is real. The battle is not with flesh and blood, but with Satan and his demonic forces. Yet, I am more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus, and I stand victorious in him. Today, I make this declaration in and through Jesus Christ. I will no longer be bound by the lies, deception, and accusations of the enemy. I know the truth, and his name is Jesus. I will face temptations from my position in Christ and with the Word of God. I renounce and repent for believing the lie that Satan is stronger than God. I reject darkness and the ways of this world and choose his life, and by his grace and power will live in his light. With this declaration, I make my stand, and here I will stand. For me to live is Christ, for Christ is my life. Then give the Lord a praise offering, saints. Now we're going to do one more thing. I know it's almost 1 o'clock. You're going, oh, listen, the Pentecostals will eat fast, and we'll be able to get into the restaurants, okay? Let's go get the kids. Go get the kids and bring the kids in. We're going to worship with one more song before we go out, okay? Mingle among yourselves. The topic is spiritual warfare. Get the kids, bring them in. Let's have one more worship.
Fire, with jealous and a pure desire, strong enough to
to be the sacrifice that set us free. You have taken all our sins away. You have risen and you've won the day. God, you have broken every bond and chain in your love. God, you're always breaking through the dark, breaking into lives and healing hearts. Your love is from the veil. Your love can never fail. Your love is making all things new. God, you're always breaking through the dark, breaking into lives and healing hearts. Your love is from the veil. Your love can never fail. Your love is making all things new.
Yes, our hearts are yours. You've ransomed us with your blood. We lift up one voice. We lift up one voice. We sing and we shout for joy. For now we are yours. Yes, our hearts are yours. You've ransomed us with your blood. God, you're always breaking through the dark, breaking into lives and healing hearts. Your love is torn the veil. Your love can never fail. Your love is making all things new, yeah. God, you're always breaking through the dark, breaking into lives and healing hearts. Your love is torn the veil. Your love can never fail. Your love is making all things new, yeah. God, you're always breaking through the dark. Your love can never fail. Your love is making all things new.
Miss next week either. It's part two. And we'll get to it quicker so we're not here so late, okay? Wait. Turn to somebody. Pair up. Turn to somebody. Okay? You can do three, okay? Look them face to face. Say this. You are more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. You are more than a conqueror.
In Christ Jesus.
And ask him this, who's your daddy?
Who's your daddy?
Okay. No. Don't let the enemy get in there. Yes, sir. Yeah.